BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
I spotted Jo Wheatley straight away. As she pulled into the car park of the Dorset station where we met, I knew it had to be her. She's a colourful character. Long, slightly wild grey hair, glasses, several small dogs by her side at all times. Jo's someone who holds what might euphemistically be called non-evidence-based beliefs. For example, she's not convinced COVID is a virus. She thinks it's a reaction to the chemicals in our environment. There are lots of people like Jo who hold fringe views about COVID, and many people, like her, now distrust mainstream media and mainstream science. But what you might not know is that this worldview was entrenched well before the COVID pandemic. For many people, it started with mad cow disease.
Oh, my words.
Jo absolutely loves cows.
Oh, moose.
She tells me about her sadness at selling her herd when she moved down to Dorset.
This one, you're very friendly.
Oh, yeah.
Aren't you? Oh, I'm sorry. Did I scare you?
Jo took over her dad's beef farm in the late 80s and ran it alone while raising three kids. She was an official in her local branch of the National Farmers Union, and she got into organic farming too. And it was that which led to a late night phone call.
Mark Purdy rang me one night through a joint friend, and he said he wanted to raise this theory. He had this theory that organophosphates had caused BSE.
Mark Purdy, who we heard about in the last episode, the hippie farmer turned self-taught scientist who developed the theory that organophosphate pesticides had caused cow prion proteins to go rogue, causing BSE. Mark wanted Jo to get the National Farmers Union to help fund his experiments. His ideas were gaining traction before he died in 2006, never able to prove his theory. Jo became a Mark Purdy superfan, and she thinks her lovely cows have been unfairly blamed for mad cow disease. For people like Jo Wheatley, mad cow disease isn't a story about poor regulation of the meat industry. It's about powerful pharmaceutical companies and agrochemical giants. A story which seems just as relevant to her today as it was back when BSE first emerged. I'm Lucy Proctor, and from BBC Radio 4, this is The Cows Are Mad. Episode 8, Reaction.
I kept having this repetitive dream about digging up along a pipe, and then I'd find a junction box with about 9 outlets coming out of it, and then I'd find another pipe on one of those outlets and dig along that and find another junction box. It just kept on like that. I can still see it now if I think about it. It's not nice.
This is one of Jo Wheatley's old friends, Richard Bruce. Richard's also a retired farmer who lives on the Isle of Wight. This dream he's telling me about, it's one he started having some 30 years ago after he accidentally spilled liquid pesticide over his arms and legs while working as a grain farmer. You'll hear as Richard Bruce talks that he struggles to breathe. He's got heart problems as well as chronic fatigue and some cognitive impairment.
Right, who else we got here?
He's been stuck in a bureaucratic nightmare for the last 3 decades. Several doctors have told him he has symptoms of organophosphate pesticide poisoning, but there were no witnesses to the spill, and his former employer denies anything happened. And therefore, Richard says the authorities have told him he can't have pesticide poisoning, and so in turn, can't seek compensation.
My symptoms were, although they were consistent with poisoning, they were due to a mindset that believes in poisoning. I've been well gaslighted, I have.
Richard Bruce is a man who's wary of official statements of fact. After his accident, he became involved in a group for farm workers who'd said they'd been harmed by pesticides.
There's my cuckoo clock again.
He got into the green movement too.
Only cuckoo we've heard in years.
And then, in the early 90s, he began to hear about fellow farmer Mark Purdy and his theory that pesticides were behind the BSE outbreak. For years, anti-pesticide campaigners have been collecting stories about the alleged harms they caused, like these, told to a BBC documentary back in 1988.
Spraying started one evening by a helicopter, which we later had identified, and it flew around the fields spraying on one side of the valley. We felt almost immediately that we were attacked by some form of flu.
Stories of strange symptoms, fatigue and psychiatric disturbances that no doctor could find any explanation for.
The only way I can describe it was just a blackness.
The BSE crisis helped get concerns about a possible chemical threat to our brains onto the news agenda.
Tell me what that is.
That was the first edition of the Tomorrow's World magazine.
So you were in the first ever Tomorrow's World magazine?
That's right.
Wow.
Wherever it is, there it is.
We've gone to war with pests that used to plague us. Now we enjoy pristine produce in the shops and perfect roses in the garden. But there's a price to pay, and we've only just begun to find out how much. When's this from? 1998,
I think it was. Up there, isn't it?
Richard Bruce was no trained chemist, but he became another citizen scientist. He compiled pages of research, which in the early days of the internet, he then published on a website.
In here somewhere, I've got some photos of some of my experiments.
He did experiments to try and test industry claims about how quickly certain chemical compounds break down in the body.
Mixed up in 97 and then tested 4 months later, and it killed flies.
And he submitted all his findings to the official BSE inquiry. The corporations that Richard Bruce and many others think were to blame for both BSE and chronic illness in humans are giants. In the line of fire in the early days was ICI, once Britain's biggest manufacturer, which made the pesticide organic farmer Mark Purdy claimed had caused BSE. In the early 90s, ICI was spun out into various smaller companies, including Zeneca, which became AstraZeneca. Whatever the name, big pharma and big chemical companies are all one enemy, as far as Richard Bruce is concerned.
I think BSE opened people's eyes to the fact that we couldn't trust the officials. I think the cows were blamed to protect the chemical and pharmaceutical industry.
Some people listening to that would say that sounds a bit like a conspiracy theory.
Ah, well, like I keep saying, it only takes two people to cause a conspiracy. And once you've got the proof, it's not a theory no more, it's fact. And I actually believe the facts stand up for the facts.
But there's no proof this conspiracy is true. That cows were blamed for BSE to cover up the effects of agrochemicals on humans and animals. No leaked memos, no whistleblowers. The alleged link between pesticides, BSE and vCJD has never been proved, so that conspiracy remains a theory. But that's not stopped people like Richard Bruce and Joe Wheatley from believing. They point to other loose ends, other unanswered questions, that if you put them together in a certain way, start to tell a story. Joe Wheatley sat in the public gallery as evidence was gathered during the BSE inquiry in the late 90s. She listened through the testimonies about the failures in the meat industry, but she was more interested in another, less publicised section of the review, medicines and cosmetics. Because right at the beginning of the BSE crisis, the government wasn't just thinking about the risks to people from meat.
I sat there, I couldn't believe the evidence they were giving about the use of bovine tissues in medical.
Officials from the Ministries of Health and Agriculture spent years in the late 80s and early 90s worrying about what they called biologicals, drugs made in part from living organisms, including bits of cow.
So it ended up that you could inject anything, any bovine material that you wanted, and it wasn't a problem. Yet you eat a beef burger or a sausage, then it's going to, you know, give you CJD. That doesn't add up to me.
One thing officials were horrified to learn at the start of the crisis was that one of the cow parts used in biologicals for cattle was the pituitary gland, highly infective when it came to BSE. Vets were using the glands to harvest hormones, which they'd re-inject back into living cows to speed up their growth. The officials had in mind a previous scandal, one which had affected humans.
This is what was injected into the children, usually several times a week and for several years.
Starting in the late 1950s, children of so-called short stature had been given hormones harvested from humans that were unknowingly suffering from the existing form of CJD, the one that existed before BSE.
It's made from pituitary glands taken from human corpses.
Many people around the world died. If humans could spread CJD to other humans by injecting human growth hormone, surely doing the same thing with cow growth hormone could spread BSE. At least, that's the logic. But this possible route of infection was never properly investigated.
Why wasn't it put to the test?
Another loose end people like Richard and Joe point to is vaccines. Cow's blood and calf's blood serum is used to grow some vaccines. And so, in the late 80s and early 90s, health officials tried to find out how many cows potentially harbouring BSE might have been used in the vaccines sitting on shelves at the time. The drug companies said they didn't have detailed databases of the bovine ingredients they used. Records at the regulators had been lost. New rules were brought in to prevent cow parts from infected herds being used for new vaccines, and the drug companies went abroad to source bovine material where there was no BSE. Ultimately, research published in 1993 showed it was very unlikely human vaccines could have been infective. But in his report, Public Inquiry Chair Lord Phillips says there couldn't be a 100% guarantee that vaccines had been safe. One vaccine was recalled, and suspicion has remained. People like Joe and Richard are trying to piece together a jigsaw puzzle, and some of the pieces are in the right place, but many more are not, and there are some big holes to fill. They've jammed pieces together to put the drug companies at the centre of the BSE crisis. And it's a picture that sustained their belief all these years that the government narrative can't be trusted.
So we know the coronavirus can likely live on this surface.
Which is why, with the pandemic, Richard doesn't believe the consensus on that either. He's got his own COVID origin theory.
And I do wonder if these viruses are really phosphates that are being replicated by the body. All the symptoms are very similar.
I suppose the difference with COVID is they can see the COVID virus in the microscope.
That's what they say.
You don't believe that they can see the virus in the microscope?
I've no idea. I haven't seen it. But I've been hearing all sorts of things about this. And I thought, they don't know what they're talking about here. And I thought, this is a bit odd. They're all very highly trained and taught all these clever things. But do they really know? And I'm not sure they do.
Richard Bruce and Joe Wheatley are not alone. There are other people, connected via social media, newsletters, online forums, who've drawn on their suspicions about Big Pharma, fermented during the mad cow years, to fuel new suspicions about the same companies in the COVID vaccination programme. For many people in this world, science that comes out of industry or universities is suspect. It's the citizen scientists, the renegade doctors, and the independent investigators who say they know the real truth. Next time on The Cows Are Mad, can mainstream science fight back and finally provide some answers? The Cows Are Mad is written and produced by me, Lucy Proctor. Sound design and mix by James Beard. Original music by Pete Cunningham. The editor is Richard Fenton Smith. Don't miss an episode. Subscribe to The Cows Are Mad on BBC Sounds.
Hello, it's Amol.
And I'm Nick, and we're launching the Today podcast from Radio 4.
Come on then, what is it, Nick?
Well, every week we're going to take a big subject we want to spend more time on, because I don't know about you, when I present the Today programme, I'm always thinking of things I wish I'd asked, I wish I'd heard. And this is going to give us the time to do that, to get more analysis, more insight, sometimes more gossip.
Same goes for me. I'm looking forward to this. Episodes will drop every Thursday. It's called the Today podcast, and you can listen now on BBC Sounds. We'll be right back.